Lothar, how is life coach? Like, I didn't talk much to him today or yesterday, but he seems cheerful and he's definitely happy that he made it here and already just one win away from day three.
Well, he's always like that. He's always like, you know, there's a certain reason why his nickname is life coach, because he is actually like, you know, that type of person that can you give life advice.
Right.
I would say he's always cheerful. He's always analyzing everything and always tries to find the bright side of every situation possible. So seeing him cheerful is nothing really new, but when he goes into that mindset, when he starts playing, he's like super focused like on the things about the game. You can see that on his face when he's playing. Like, no one else, I think, has that amount of motivation like painted on his face during the game.
Yeah, I mean, he's a fantastic player to watch from that aspect. You know, as much as people can get frustrated with the amount of time he takes on every turn, just you can spend that time just watching his facial expressions and just be plenty entertained for the length of the rope.
On the other hand, JJ, I was talking to him a lot today, and before matches, before the group started, he was upset in a way that, hey, I ended up in the group of death. It's going to be really hard. And Nimsh, why is it so much pressure on me? But after winning the first match and now facing Life Coach, he seems really determined. He feels like, yep, I'm going to win versus Life Coach. I'm going to take that match and advance to the top eight. So he changed a bit after the first win. It gave him confidence.
I think it's also a really interesting matchup of player personalities, because we just talked about sort of Life Coach's like slow, considered style. JJ's a very impulsive, almost impatient at time players. We were just backstage watching a match with him beforehand, and within 3 seconds of a turn coming up, he's going, oh, come on, what are you doing? This is the play, just do it, get on with it. Like, what are you thinking about? And that's just kind of how he reacts to the game. It's how he plays the game. He's a very, very impulsive player, sees the optimal lines most of the time very, very quickly. So it'd be interesting to see if Life Coach kind of drags him down to his pace, or whether JJ just speeds up and tries to power through it. So yeah, be an interesting matchup, I think.
Absolutely. Let's talk about the lineups.
Sure.
So what they are playing? JJ is playing his trusty rogue,
yep,
Paladin and Warrior.
And Life Coach plays a Druid, Rogue, and a Warlock. So
yeah,
you can kind of tie two classes to each of those players, right? The Rogue to the JJ and the Warlock to Life Coach, because he was known for playing Handlock for three-fourth of his career, right, when it comes to Hearthstone. And it's still a good deck. I'm not sure if he's playing this, or maybe I'm sure, I'm just not wanna say it right now. But he was known for playing it perfectly. He was one of the best pilots of Handlock ever, and it's still a good deck, so maybe he brought it here.
Yeah, I remember when Life Coach was at the Gfinity tournament in the UK, and I had something like a 40-minute conversation with him about Ancient Watcher versus Lifetap on turn two in one game. That's just the level of knowledge that he has, like the level of interest and intricacy that he has with Handlock. And you know, that was months and months ago. I'm sure it's only deepened since then, even though Handlock has almost been forced out of the meta by the other Warlock control decks, the Reno variants. You know, it's still a very, very powerful deck, and if you are a master of Handlock, it makes a lot of sense to keep running it.
Actually, I think there's a small chance we have a mistake on the overlay, because I was under the impression that JJ actually brought the Warlock himself instead of Warrior.
Yes, I have, obviously, JJ, my Complexity teammate, I did a little bit of planning for this matchup backstage with him, and yes, I am 99% confident he is bringing a Warlock and not a Warrior here, so. Easy mistake to make, right? WAR.
Absolutely, absolutely. And the players could change their decks, and this is the first time we show JJ on screen today. Mm-hmm. So absolutely. So if JJ is bringing Warlock, Paladin, and Rogue, how does the matchup versus Druid, Rogue, and Warlock?
So we were discussing it backstage, and we feel like JJ's lineup is pretty favored. There's you know, maybe there's one matchup that he wants to avoid. He wants to keep his Paladin to target the Druid specifically. If he can get that matchup in his favor, he feels like the rest of the decks line up really, really well in his favor. So that's the main thing he'll be trying to engineer.
Okay. Well, then the first pick will be very important.
Yes.
Otherwise, you might be in a position when there will be an uphill battle, because if you lose the first one and you lose the class that you probably wanted to counter with, right, and you probably won't open the match with it, but then that leaves a lot of space for Life Coach to pick the first class.
Exactly.
So it's like the mind games all over the place.
Yeah, it's something that happened. I played a tournament game last night against Raven, one of our co-casters, and you know, he said to me afterwards, like, I can't believe you led with Patron, because like that's the one deck that, like, you know, I just didn't expect you to pick. And I'm like, of course, that's why I picked it, because it's the one deck you expect me not to lead with. Like, that's the mind games in the opening pick is just one of the most interesting thing about tournament formats, and one of the things that goes under the radar, everyone's really quick to judge, you know, how did they play mechanically, what happened inside the games, but so much of tournaments happens outside with your preparation, your pick and ban strategy, your deck building, all that kind of stuff. So.
Absolutely, and it's amazing to talk to those pro players also after the match, like what was your strategy with the picks specifically, right. What matchups you wanted to find and play, because sometimes like one deck is definitely disadvantaged and you need to win one specific match.
Yeah.
But, well, you can't find it. But with Last Hero Standing, it's maybe easier to find the specific matchup because the deck that wins actually stays. So
yes.
If you have a specific counter, you can play against the deck that won. Where in Conquest, like it's kind of hit and miss, where you basically just, if the deck you wanted to face won already, like you will not be able to face it.
Right. The thing is, like, if you win, you can kind of win the wrong match in Conquest. It's kind of a weird thing, but you know, you have a deck that's good against a deck, and you win with it, and therefore it's eliminated. Like, there's no such thing as a bad win, but there's an unimportant win in Conquest. Whereas
yeah.
Last Hero Standing is much more polarized. Of like, if you lose one deck at the wrong time, that can be the whole death of the series.
Absolutely. And game number one is ready here, so. We don't see Warlock from JJ, that's a rogue, and Warlock from Life Coach.
Yep.
Who won the game, the mind game here?
I would say that Life Coach, probably. It's still a close matchup, especially if JJ is building, bringing here a specifically built rogue, an example of Maligos.
Right.
I'm not sure if he's bringing that, we'll see, right? For now, we know that he has double Violet Teachers, which might say something about the build that he's. He's bringing, might not be even oil.
Yeah, of course, JJ was one of the players to really bring Malagos Rogue back with a splash, getting rank one legend with it, really pushing out one of the first like really, really strong meta lists that people started copying. But yeah, the Tinker's oil draw solves that dilemma for us. No Malagos here, just standard oil rogue. So this is a somewhat tough matchup for the rogue, but it can be made very possible with well-timed usage of Blade Flurry, I'd say, because you can generally just sit around and build up a big dagger with your weapon buffs over and over again. There's usually no weapon destruction from the Hamlock side, so you can just threaten a big dagger all the time, and then suddenly their big wall of giants just isn't as imposing.
Historically, this matchup was actually really bad for the rogue.
Yeah.
But since introduction of the oil and the Blade Flurry, bigger presence, I would say, in the metagame, it kind of slightly changed for the rogue.
Yeah, and also like we can see now clearly, like what you Lothar said, this is a handlock with demons that we've seen before Life Coach playing.
Yeah, I think even for a while after the oil rogue variant came about, like it was still considered really heavily favored for the handlock, but then it wasn't really a change in the deck, it was just people figured out the matchup from the rogue side and really like pushed the matchup back their way a little bit.
It's very similar to what Patron Warrior, the first charge iteration, how the matchup looked for the Patron Warrior in the first iteration against the Warlock, against the Handlock, because everyone was saying, like, this is such a horrible matchup for the Patron, right? But then when people actually started to figure it out and they saw that Frothing Berserk is the key, not the Patron Warrior anymore, then they shifted their strategy to, you know, play it differently. And the same happens, well, as you said.
So coining out the Void Caller here does have that Jiraxxus in hand to get a nice presence on the board, but it's just going to get answered by the Violet Teacher here and demand a slightly off-curve play here if he wants to deal with the Violet Teacher, trying to prevent him just from playing another 4-drop this turn.
How good is Jiraxxus in like as a 3/15 on board versus Rogue?
I mean, it's reasonable. Of course, it's a sap target, but sap is actually interesting. One of the cards that's starting to make way from Oil Rogue. Some people are going down to one copy of sap at the moment. So you know, if it comes down as a 3/15 and there's no sap in your opponent's hand and they have to like look at dealing with it through damage, like there's no way you're going to commit 15 damage to dealing with a Jiraxxus as
Absolutely.
A rogue. So
well, I asked specifically because right now he can use one of the Hellfires to basically kill the Violet Teacher, deal with the problem, and have Jiraxxus on top of that.
I mean, I don't hate that. Hellfire isn't an overly great card in this matchup, so having two of them in your hand, it might be a consideration to at least get it out and play.
I would say that the Jiraxxus is not important until it will get taunted up.
Right.
Either by the Sunfield Protector or Defensive Argus.
Yep.
So Life Coach might not be just even going for the Jiraxxus. This turn might not make any sense to play it, especially since you don't want to waste the Sunfield Protector yet.
Right, I mean, he could have got the Jiraxxus on board this turn with the Hellfire, and then his next turn, Ancient Watcher Sunfury, for example. But yeah, it's extremely exposed to sap for sure, and it's a risky play. Doesn't need to spend too much resource dealing with that Violet Teacher just yet. He does have that AoE in hand, so even if the tokens do get out of control, he has the Hellfire to clean it up. So I like the more solid line overall.
There is no sap though, so this Voidwalker looks not that good for JJ. He needs to do something about it.
I think he will just ignore it. Maybe just play Belcher and go face for free damage. Just leave it up.
Yeah, it seems reasonable. I feel like just interacting with it now just kind of gives the minion charge that your opponent's going to get, because you don't really hold any illusion of dealing with it this turn when it comes out. So, yeah, the Belcher to wall it out and just make Life Coach at least have the minion come out with Summoning Sickness so it doesn't have any initiative on his turn.
Good. Summoning Sickness.
That's a nice term. But the good news for JJ is that he actually has a lot of weapon buffs. And you guys mentioned at the very beginning, like, you want to have a big dagger. That's something that he can build up in the couple of next turns. And
yeah, he's just missing that crucial Blade Flurry piece. And it looks like JJ is going to commit to killing the Voidcaller this turn, try and protect his Belcher. So the Jiraxxus does come down here. And wow, that is a huge card for this matchup. Acidic
Swampoos. We are
talking
today about use during Dragfest. Because we knew how the groups will be most likely open, right? Just by judging how the Swiss, went. So you can judge, like, when first place against 16, second against.
Yep.
And so on and so on, right? So Life Coach knew that he'll most likely face two opponents with weapon classes.
Yeah.
So bringing a Ooze to the Handlock or whatever Warlock he would be bringing might be a very good option. Right?
Yeah, and it seems like it's going to be amazing with the Deadly Poisons and Tinker's Oil just sitting in JJ's hand. Obviously not this turn, but do you just go for Mountain Giant this turn? Just play another big threat on board?
I don't see too much wrong with that. The alternative play is just to make a defensive line with the Sun Fury Protector, which he can totally do, get another life tap in there as well, but that doesn't really react to the board particularly well. So interesting, going for the Sun Fury first here. So what's he doing with the rest of his turn now? He's going to play the Ooze.
Oh,
wow.
Interesting. It's a bit of an aggressive play here.
Well, he knows that there's no preparation in his opponent hand and no sap, right? He has that knowledge just by seeing the Violet Teacher without the prep, without the sap, right?
Yep.
So you know what's happening. So his hand from JJ is most likely clunky, no backstabs. The Fan of Knights would probably have been used already to just cycle through that hand. So that gives a lot of information for Life Coach and how he might approach this game. So the Ooze just buys tempo here because it buys two mana from the Rogue, which then implies that there will be really clunky turns in overall for JJ in the future, right? So I like this. I mean, it's a really completely opposite of what we usually see from Life Coach. The not greedy play at all.
Right.
So it's kind of surprising, and that also might caught JJ, like, you know, off guard.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely, and it does in a way, because for now JJ doesn't have a really great play I can see, and overextending into second Violet Teacher might be too much. Like, you don't know if Life Coach has a Shadow Flame in his hand. We know there's double Hellfire, which would be annoying for Life Coach himself just dealing with his own board. So what do you do here?
He's going to go ahead and quit the double poison now, which, yeah, having seen that Ooze used, you're pretty confident there isn't going to be two weapon destruction cards in your opponent's deck. So the deadly poison coming out here, smashing down, eviscerate on the Ooze to take it out, and he's slowly whittling away at this board, but still lacking the Blade Flurry that he's really going to need to leverage this huge dagger going forward.
He has the sprint, though.
Yep.
It will take a whole turn to build it up, but you have five draws to get the Blade Flurry, and this will be the MVP card in this matchup.
Yeah, and also, like, you do force Life Coach to do something with this board at this very moment. Like, he obviously has a Hellfire. The Hellfire will take 4 mana from him, and he won't be able to do much afterwards.
Yeah, it does tie up the turn a little bit. He has the option to just keep going with big threats here if he feels safe enough with this 312 taunt in play. You know, he can play, he can do tap Twilight Drake, he can Twilight Drake and create even more taunts, or he can just commit the Mountain Giant straight up to the board. So there's an interesting divergence of play here where Life Coach has to decide whether he's the aggressor or the defender in this situation. And it looks like, based on this, that we are going to see just more threats played onto the board.
Yeah, Mountain Giant is a big minion. 8/8/8 that needs to be responded to. Sap would be a great card to deal with this Mountain Giant, but there's no sap for JJ yet.
Backstab is not helping. And what we need here is a preparation and sap. Or preparation and a Blade Flurry. two misses.
And he gets
and that's
neither.
Nothing. Ooh. That's actually a horrible sprint.
That is a really ugly sprint. Yeah, no real gas even going forward now. He really needed to pick up those Blade Flurries or the Saps. You know, even his second Eviscerate would have possibly been able to get something done. But yeah, nothing coming into hand. Just more and more minions. Not what he needs right now. He needs ways to answer this board from Life Coach. And so he's gonna have to try and find an emergency play here.
That Jaraxxus is just ridiculous when you think about the damage that is soaking in. You don't need the Hellfire. The Hellfire might actually be the finisher of the game. Think about it as a Leeroy. 8 mana Leeroy deals 6 damage to
the
face.
Yeah, sure.
This might be the way that Life Coach wants to play this game. Because right now, you just drop, boom. You go face for 11, 13 damage. Mm-hmm. Your opponent is at 10.
I think you might actually kill the 3-2.
Yeah, I think you can afford, like, play Boom, go face with the two big guys, and just trade the Sun Fury to the Violet Teacher. Seems reasonable.
It's still setting up lethal for next turn. Like, you do you have Dr. Boom and 8-6 Giant and double Hellfire in your hand.
But do you care about the Violet Teacher?
I mean, it creates some more flexibility for your opponent, right? It gives them, having just sprinted, you know, Life Coach doesn't know how bad this hand is that he's looking back at. So by giving him that source of 3 damage on the board, you know, that enables things like Eviscerate plus the Violet Teacher to go into the 3-7, and suddenly your board, you know, the math just starts to add up to things disappearing. So I respect the trade here from Life Coach for sure, but like, if any of this other damage goes anywhere else, I'll be amazed.
3 damage to 1-1? Not really.
Yeah, doesn't seem necessary when your dude has Taunt and hasn't been sapped for a long time. But again, Sprint has just been cast, so Sap will again be in your mind.
So is there anything that can help JJ right now?
A disconnect.
Shh.
Oh yeah, I want to curse the tournament again.
Azure Drake Eviscerate, not really. This Jaraxxus is just too big. 3-7. No Sap.
You can go for the Fan of Knives and maybe get a Blade Flurry from the top.
Yeah.
And then you can play Eviscerate. Oh, look at that.
Oh,
so that's six damage, actually. So you are able to kill everything.
If the 1-1 survives.
Flurry now for 6, and then a 1-1 goes into the Boom. Yeah, all right, that Blade Flurry draw. So being facetious aside, obviously Blade Flurry was the one card he needed, whiffing on it so far. If he'd have drawn it naturally, he could have also combined it with the Tinker's Oil, but the Drake there, just enough to get it off that last draw, and that was the very, very last moment that JJ could afford to answer this board. So.
Yeah, now it looks interesting. So for Life Coach, he can go for the Drake and the Taunt. He does not win with double Hellfire, 6 damage. But you can double Hellfire and go for Molten, but then like you deal 6 damage to yourself and you're playing versus Rogue that has 7 cards in hand.
And he didn't use a single Eviscerate. Yes.
He used one.
He used one. Just one has been used.
Okay.
It's also an interesting scenario because we were talking about the Violet Teacher trade on the previous turn. So let's say he hadn't chosen to trade the Violet Teacher. There would obviously be a bigger board. There would have been better trades with the 3-2. But also, he would have done 2 extra damage to face, which means that double Hellfire would have ended up being lethal there. So really hard to... Ooh!
That's close.
Let me just cut off my train of thought, because now Hellfire and Dart Bomb on the following turn is just straight up lethal, but we do see the Earthen Ring Farseer in hand, but there's also the matter of a Molten Giant on board to
you
deal with right now.
You have to deal with the Molten Giant yourself. You have to actually do that. Those 2 things, right? So you need a sap.
You need a sap. You need to fan into sap, I believe.
Right, and again, like, it's very possible there's only one sap in this list. It's a thing that people are really starting to come around to now because it's just a less effective card with all the decks just being much faster, much more efficient, tempo-based stuff. The sap just isn't as dramatic as it used to be anymore.
Yeah, it doesn't really convince me, but I'm a fan of 2 saps.
I still like 2 saps as well.
The thing is, you need to fan into sap from our perspective. From JJ's perspective, you have to assume there is no way to kill you. Like, you need to deal with Molten Giant,
right?
But you cannot assume there is Hellfire and Dark Bomb or double Dark Bomb in Life Coach's hand. Because if there are, you just lost. Like, if you go for Fan into Sap, that's cool.
SI Agent is not going to get the job done.
No. Nope.
Not enough mana, yeah.
He's going to Fan again. This is not going to leave him with enough mana to do both. So even if he gets the Sap here, he's going to be dead.
Yeah, he knows he's dead to the Multi Giant.
But what he was fishing for was either a Sap or a Prep. Both of those draws were giving him out to deal the damage needed for the Molten Giants. That was his reasoning to play the second Fan of Knives, right? He wasn't able to play around, of course, the Hellfire and Dark Bomb, but he did what was necessary to have an out for the current board state.
So now JJ is left with his Warlock and Paladin. We have Warlock changed. So you were right, Solo.
Yeah. I was pretty confident, having done his preparation with him, that it was a Warlock and not a Warrior, but, you know.
Last minute change.
JJ's a troll. He might have just been sat back there trolling me the whole time. Like, this guy thinks he's helping. I'm just playing Warrior.
It's like 30-minute strategy meeting because he trolled you.
Yeah. Makes sense. But yeah, I think we're going to see a Warlock mirror here, because as you will very quickly see, JJ is playing Malygos Warlock, which is famously the Warlock deck that you bring to beat other Warlock decks. So.
And that's because you have a lot of bursts. So basically you go head-to-head most of the time, the early turns, and then like both players go lower because the Handlock wants to go lower to play Molten Giants, but then like Malygos Rogue has, Malygos Warlock has so much burst.
Yeah, and also traditionally you're playing double Big Game Hunter in Malygos Warlock, so you know, throw as many Giants as you want at me as long as that number is two or less, and I'm able to deal with them quite efficiently.
That's a good target for the Voidcaller, but this time there's no Voidcaller yet.
Yeah.
It's amazing your hand for JJ, just early opening to deal some damage in the very beginning. And for Life Coach, it doesn't look that good. Like, maybe the Life Tap will help a bit.
I would love to see the brand now coined out on turn two, just to get the value from the
Dark Peddler.
Dark Peddler
on turn three.
Yep, I love it.
To have a Soulfire and a PO, an example. Oh, he tapped instead.
Decides to tap. Interesting stuff. Yeah, I mean, I kind of like the coin brand into Dark Peddler there as well. You just give yourself so many more options going forward and refill your hand anyway for things like Twilight Drakes.
Yeah, but on the other hand, like if you think about this matchup, like what you want to have is probably the spells you have in your deck and Torison. So by tapping, it's just in the early game you have time.
Sure.
You have enough time to play what you have, but you necessarily need to get the combo cards and Thorison to be able to just win the game.
And I guess what this does as well is you play Bran into a turn where Handlock is wanting to play a big threat. So even if, say, they do have Dark Bomb Mortal Coil here, if that comes out, then you're still in a position where you've blocked them from playing their big four mana dude. So.
And you still keep the coin for the future. You might need the coin.
Did he just rip the owl? I'm pretty sure he just ripped the owl.
Yep,
he did. All right, nice.
Wow, okay.
So that Drake is going to get silenced twice right now, just for maximum BM. Two cards picked up from Peddler. We're going to see the Owl come down, then I'm sure the coin Mortal Coil will come out as well. So this is a pretty disgusting start from JJ right now.
That's
yeah, true. Without Hellfire, or like how do you even come back from this situation? It will be tough.
Yeah, what? Screw you, buddy. Shut up twice.
Unsilence it.
Yeah, I mean, we're still waiting for our unsilence card, right? IMB Cow, the Ruiner of Fun, still, so.
Well, there's the Resurrect for Shaman.
That's true.
Well, there is a chance that IMB Cow can be nerfed, actually.
Speaking of drawing the exact card you need, Hellfire with 5 mana with that 1 spare mana for Mortal Coil is pretty glorious here for Life Coach. Pretty much undoing all of that hard work from JJ in the first few turns.
Hold it. And now Void Caller will be nice follow up overall for Life Coach to come back.
Yep, JJ does get to keep going with the initiative, though. Develops Drake, keeps control of the board, so still has a very, very flexible hand with the spell power in play, Implosion, Dart Bomb, lots of tempo cards able to be used to destroy some minions that come down from Life Coach.
So is Life Coach doing just schools in the front of Argus this turn to be able to have more minions on board and contest the 4-4 Drake?
I feel like that gets picked apart pretty easily when your opponent has a Drake on board that they can leverage spell power with, but honestly, it's just a kind of miserable-looking hand right now for Life Coach, so it's hard to find a play that I like at all.
Doomguard is too risky, probably, because you want to play Dr. Boom on 7.
You want also to keep the Mal'Ganis. The only expendable card here is Ooze, and maybe Sunfire Protector, not counting the Mortal Core, right?
So. Yeah. Taps to try and pick up an option. Still had 4 mana open, so basically any of his big threats would have been a great play there, but Hellfire, not what he's looking for. Just going to play out the Acidic Ooze and the Sun Fury Protector, and these Mortal Coils in JJ's hand are going to start getting some work done.
They are devastating, but the tap was okay. Like, you still look for Ancient Watcher or maybe Void Caller to be able to play it for 4 mana.
The Big Game Hunter is also a game changer here, because the Dr. Boom next turn now has an answer. And that looks horrible for Life Coach right now. He doesn't know it yet, but I'm sure that he is anticipating it.
Absolutely. And he's also like getting lower and lower on health. So that implosion was actually for 2.
Yeah,
so
that was a low roll implosion, yeah. Ah, good old implosion. We're all going to be really sad to see the back of that card, right, Lothar?
No.
Couldn't even bring yourself to go with the sarcasm. Just
no, away. No, I'm just, you know.
Lothar, which card do you hate most? Innervate or Implosion?
No, I think actually it's Innervate that brings the most hate out of me.
Okay.
But in general, there are a lot of cards that I'm not missing.
Yeah.
I will not be missing after the introduction of Standard.
Innervate is still there, but maybe it will get there.
Yeah, who knows?
Who knows? We'll see how it goes.
We saw one pretty good Hellfire Mortal Coil turn from Life Coach. This one is not too bad either. Gets another 5 heal from the Hellfire Mortal Coil again to pick off the last 4 health target. And he is fighting from behind pretty consistently in this matchup, but he's doing it pretty well so far.
Yes, it's going well so far, seeing the advantage that JJ had. And right now, JJ doesn't have that many combo cards in his hand. Like, he goes for Torrison, he will hit the Dark Bomb, which is good, but it's only Dark Bomb. Like, normally you want to have Malygus at least in the same hand.
Double Aegislix Swamp.
So, Lothar, this whole time during the Rogue matchup where I was sat around talking about weapon destruction, you just let me sound like an idiot.
No, no, I just didn't want, you know, to...
I understand.
To destroy the excitement.
Yeah, still,
you know?
Lothar's just sitting there like, this guy has no idea. There's so much weapon destruction in this deck.
Harrison Jones there as well?
2 Oozes hand and a Harrison in Handlock? Yeah, that'll be the day.
Well, if you face JJ and Dog in your group, you might actually consider that.
Right, sure. I mean, seems reasonable. But yeah, Big Game Hunters are going to start getting their work done now. Big Game Hunter number one snipes out the... The Mountain Giant still has a second one locked and loaded, ready to go for either Dr. Boom or Mal'Ganis. And again, a Mortal Coil for 2 is just providing JJ with so much initiative here.
Yeah, and we also have to think about this Malygus. It will come to JJ's hand at some point and just add extra 5 spell damage.
It looks very bleak for Life Coach, to be honest. Like, everything that he will play will be dealt with immediately.
Yeah.
And now it looks like a typical Zoo scenario. Zoo just plays minions, trades, or just goes phase and uses his implosions to trade with your minions, and that's basically it.
Is the Life Coach just dead next turn almost? Like, if he goes for Dr. Boom, I think he just dies, right? There's like 8 damage on board, and then with spell damage, Dark Bomb is 4 damage, Hellfire is 4 damage, and there's +2 from. It's basically 18 damage for JJ.
Yeah, he does actually have exactly 18 right now if Dr. Boom is played, so. Life Coach is going to have to try and make a defensive play here if he feels like he needs to react to that situation. But, you know, just
he will play to win.
It's a weird thing about Hearthstone. Just because your opponent has lethal does not make playing around lethal the correct play. And I'm aware how bizarre that sounds to a lot of people, but I promise you it's true.
I do support that. And Dr. Boom seems like the best play here because you need to have some board to be able to fight back. But this gives opportunity to JJ to seal the game if he sees that spell damage extras.
I'm sure he's.
Well, now he is definitely lethal with the. Well, that was lethal before, but with the Blackwing Corruptor.
Yeah, Blackwing Corruptor simplifies things. You don't have to worry about, you know, blowing up your own dudes with Hellfire by accident or anything. But yeah, he's just going to go ahead and use the Hellfire. Boombots are going to punish him a little bit, get that revenge damage. But the important thing is that JJ levels up the series 1-1.
Yeah, 1-1. So we talked about it. This was a bad matchup to begin with. But now, Malygus Warlock versus the rest of Life Coach's lineup. So. What does he have left? He has Druid and the Rogue.
And the Rogue.
Yeah. And Life Coach is famous for playing a slightly weird version of Miracle Rogue. He has the Gadgetzan Auctioneers, but not really a genuine win condition, you'd
say. No win condition Rogue.
Right, yeah. There's, you know, no Charge Minion Shadow Step combo, no Malygos combo. It's just kind of Gadgetzan Auctioneer with board presence.
On
winning
curve.
Through that way. Yeah, yeah, yeah. But yeah, talking to JJ, his Malygos Warlock was the deck that he put a lot of faith in for this matchup. He thinks it's good against the lineup apart from Druid, and then he wanted to reserve his Paladin to deal with the Druid. So I expect the way we see this series develop now is that Druid comes out here, takes out the Malygos Warlock in theory, just playing it by the odds, and then we see the Paladin come out from JJ.
Yeah.
And then the Rogue will be playing against Paladin, which skews the matchup in theory for Life Coach.
Yeah, that's right.
So this is the Fury. The practical view might be different.
Yeah, the practical is a bit different because Malygos Warlock still has a good chance to win versus Druid. Actually, if you have a good opening and if you take the early game, it's similar to Dragon Priest versus Druid, where if you curve out, you just have big minions in the very beginning and Druid does not respond to this. Druid cannot come back.
Yeah, Blackwing Corruptor can be really devastating against Druid. Just that ability to snipe down a minion and put a big minion of your own into play. It's that those swings on the board Druid find particularly hard to struggle with because they generally can't do it themselves. They don't have those tools in their deck to remove a minion and play a minion at the same time. They have to break it up in separate cards.
While I Drake that's unanswered and unsilenced, can also deal a lot of damage. And
just wait for the corrupted Ancient of Law that deals 5 damage to a minion.
Sure. I mean, I think Druid needs some help, right? They're a weak class right now. Give them some buffs in the new expansion.
And they lose so many cards with the rotation.
I know, it's terrible, right? Yeah, all these expansion cards they play in their decks, just crazy.
All those Piloted Shredders and Dr. Booms.
Yeah.
And Belchers, maybe.
Ah, Druids. Anyway, game of Hearthstone involving a Druid right now. He has drawn the Innovate, so he's going to have to work out how he best wants to use that Innovate, as it's just the one-off mana spike, not the consistent use of Wild Growth. But from JJ's side, this is a different style of matchup for the Malagos deck. This isn't going to be tapping, hoarding cards. This is going to be playing for tempo and just trying to get some initiative out on the board. But that is top 10 worst Dark Peddlers I have ever seen in my life.
Well, the Shulker is not that bad.
Yeah.
It's the best pick out of the three.
Right.
But look at that. Wild Growth on turn 2. Okay, I will not say that word. It's being drawn from the opposite of bottom
the
of the
upper
deck.
Portion of the deck, yeah. Wild Growth on turn 2 means that we now have Innovate Emperor on the following turn.
Yes.
JJ does have the tools to deal with it next turn, but still, the long-term value that is going to bring to Life Coach's hand
Absolutely.
Is pretty crazy.
Because then he can just follow up with the Azure Drake or whatever he wants. Like, he can do whatever he wants at this very moment.
Yep.
And still, like, Emperor Taurus not only influences his hand, but it has to be dealt with.
Yep. Absolutely.
Well, there's an easy way to deal with it because there's a brand and Abusive Surgeon, which is an awesome card when you think about it. It's one mana PO that doesn't destroy a minion.
Yep.
Right? So, awesome thing to have.
Yeah, you leave yourself a little bit exposed to swipe here, and a discounted swipe could be played alongside a discounted minion if that was Life Coach's hand, but you know, there's no choice from JJ's side in that situation. You have to react to the Emperor hitting the board, so the Bran Abusive is the clean way to do that, and as it stands, it's actually put him in a pretty reasonable position here on the board.
Yeah, even though after the Taurus and then the Wild Growth, Life Coach having great option overall, like JJ will be reactive, like he has things to do. Twilight Guardian, the fact that he got Malagos will be buffed twice, and it will actually have a taunt as well. JJ has the combo in hand. Might be too early, and he will probably be forced to use that damage spells as removal, but this game is not lost for him.
Yeah, that's the thing about Malagos Warlock, though. Back when it was being played, when it first came out, people were like, okay, so you know, you control the board, you stall, you build up this big Malagos combo, but as time and time went on, it just kind of became like tempo Dragon Warlock.
Yeah.
You just like played high quality minions, fought for the board, and the Malagos was just kind of an afterthought for some control matchups. In this matchup in particular, generally not a matchup that goes all the way to the turn where an eventual Malagos combo comes out.
So Lothar, what do you think about this turn for Life Coach going for Shade and Silence?
I was sure that the turn is to play Shade and the Keeper. I was just thinking, which option is better, to kill the Abusive Surgeon or to leave the Bran around, right? Because the problem is the Bran might be really important with the Dark Peddlers, but it's a one, Abusive Surgeon, so one. For Defender of Argus, I'm not sure if he's playing one, if JJ is playing Defender of Argus. That will be also important, but other than that,
I wasn't sure whether Life Coach was playing Oozes, Lothar, and you didn't help me out, so I'm not going to return the favor.
Sure.
And you know, even with all the discounts and extra mana crystals, for now it seems like Life Coach can only play one card. He can obviously pick something up with Azure Drake, but this is also Druid, like a lot of high minions.
Oh, I just wanted to say the Wrath.
Yeah, Wrath is great. Wrath is great, definitely. So he can either kill Bran and draw a card in the process, or can you go for kill on the Twilight Guardian?
Yeah, I don't think there's any real value in that because you still lose your Shade in the process. So I think the 2 damage on the Bran is the right line here. You can also just choose to cleanly snipe down the Shield Bearer, but that thing's not a big deal. It doesn't have too big an effect on the game overall. So yeah, 2 damage on the Bran makes the most sense here for sure. Hey, nice.
Yeah, Ancient Floor will be definitely a great card. Turn 7.
So for JJ, I think he needs to deal with that Azure Drake. Right? he needs to kill that Azure Dragon, because the spell power, if there would be a one swipe, it would be such a massive improvement for the board, because then you can deal 5 damage to the Taunted Dragon and finish it off with the hero power.
Well, there was an option to maybe just not tap, but play the Twilight and then go the Soulfire into the Drake. Or was there a possibility for like Dark Bomb and a Hero Power? But then like Soulfire will be needed for Malagos, and you can discard Malagos yourself. So JJ for now just goes for a bigger board and tries to deal enough damage to maybe put Life Coach in the combo range, himself.
Yeah, he's just going to run the risk against Swipe here. And I think against most players, if you haven't seen the Swipe happen already, you'd feel, okay, he hasn't just jammed Swipe, so he doesn't have it. But against Life Coach, you are sat there nervous for 75 seconds of the turn with no idea if he has Swipe in his hand or not right now.
Completely agree. Because a lot of turns when Life Coach will be just greedy as hell and will be waiting for the perfect opportunity to catch you off guard with that Swipe that was held for multiple turns over the course of the game.
So, is he drawing cards now? Definitely, right? It's like you do not heal at 25.
Probably not. That's a useless card. There's a target for the Big Game Hunter, unfortunately, for Life Coach in this matchup.
So, JJ, actually, this is great for JJ in a way, because he will be able to deal a lot of damage, and he knows that one heal is out of the way. But on the other hand, we know that Life Coach is building up his own board and might get close to the range to kill JJ with just Savage Rune or the combo parts.
Drew the BGH himself that turn, so having used the Abusive early, it would have been so powerful there. Abusive BGH on the Ancient of Lore, followed by trading into the Azure Drake, would have been such a huge turn. But the spell-powered Soulfire serves much the same effect here, just a clean tempo removal on the board. And this is really how you need to fight this matchup as the Warlock player, is just dominate the board every turn when you can. Don't worry too much about your hand size and your resources. Just play the game on the board.
Yeah. It works. It works for JJ right now. How can Druid come back? Like, this is not the combo turn yet.
Well, Azure Drake and Living Roots seems like a good answer to the Twilight Drake. You probably will attack with the Shade as well, just to Hero Power down the 3-6 minion.
Yeah, you can either reveal the Shade and Hero Power, or you can just play your own Shade and keep your own second Shade and keep the.
Or you can draw this.
Or you can rip Swipe. Is
but
it good
it
here, though? I don't
no,
think
not.
So, yeah.
It doesn't change that much, right?
No, it doesn't change.
So yeah, Living Roots seems great here, and then you have to make the decision between playing a second Shade or revealing your Shade and using the Hero Power to take care of that Twilight Guard.
That Swipe draw kind of changes things for the next turn, so...
I think revealing Shade is awkward in a way, because then Zombie Chow just kills it.
Right.
So it gives value to JJ.
But yeah, I mean, Life Coach will be considering the implications of, you know, Hellfire and Shadow Flame and so on, or whatever AoE package that JJ is opting to play in his deck. So he is just going to go ahead and swipe there, which is a pretty interesting line.
Yeah, I'm really...
Corruptor is a great pickup here.
I'm just trying to work that out.
Why he swiped?
Yeah.
Maybe he's... Interesting.
He wants to combo next turn.
Right. I mean, he's exposing a 4-4 to a 4-1 is the strange part of that play. Like, he's just offering up his Drake into a 4-1. So if he combos from that position, then 4 damage will have to go into the Guardian, which means that 8 plus 7 will go face, plus another 2. So
not lethal.
No,
it's not lethal.
2 will go for the Zombie Chow to just kill it, right? Mm-hmm.
But on the other hand, actually, he's seen Healbot discarded, and if he goes for face right there, and if he just deals a lot of damage, he will have still Druid of the Claw in charge and Living Roots.
Sure. Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. So yeah, just be interested to see what's in Life Coach's mind, and I'll tell you exactly what was in Life Coach's mind. It was he knew that Swipe was the very next card in his deck.
Oh my god.
Not only did he know that, he knew that JJ would make the play of being greedy with his 4-1 and not just trading it into the 4-4, and he would get the God Swipe on the following turn. So, yeah, Life Coach is just a god, short version of that.
Just pretty good swipe overall.
Calculating the odds of getting a second swipe next turn.
Yep.
So, the first thing that comes to mind is a swipe, Living
Roots,
Hero Power. Power, right?
4, 5, 6, 7 mana, and then you have 2 mana. You don't do anything.
Yeah, but you are left with your 6-6 six Shade of Nexdramas.
Yep.
Which what about
the 7 attack next turn? So 9 attack with the Savage Roar, so that's 23 with the combo.
What about
also just Druid of the Claw charge and swipe, right? Like, that's also an option.
Do you have to charge, though? Like, if you just Druid of the Claw and maybe Living Roots creating 2 1-1s? Like, there's only
sure
a 3-3 on board.
Play AOE if
yeah, I think the charge is better just to deal with the taunt straight away. And yeah, I mean, you can just attack straight away. This is totally fine too. 15 health now left, so he has combo and living roots next turn anyway.
Yeah.
So.
Oh yeah, right. I forgot about the living roots.
Yeah.
That one damage was that something that put me off, you
right.
know? And it was like, you probably don't want to leave your opponent in one.
So you need to find the taunt? Okay, this is no taunt, so basically that's it, right? Like, Life Coach has 15 damage from hand.
Yeah, I mean, he can Mortal Coil the 4-1 in order to try and pick up a taunt or a second heal bot potentially, but still then he's in serious trouble. But yep, none of these draws are going to get anything done. So Life Coach is going to continue this game down the path that we suspected it would go, where the favored decks are winning. And we're going to see if JJ's Paladin that he'd banked on beating this Druid is going to be good enough for him in this situation.
Mm-hmm.
But it wasn't a walk in the park.
No, absolutely not.
It was really close. By the way, that innervate would also increase the odds of winning when your opponent is at 15 and you're lacking a living roots.
Yeah, if there was no living roots there. Innervate.
JJ has that look on his face right now, wondering if he's dead, and he's gonna get it. Oh, Life Coach using the top deck innervate.
Nice.
yeah, definitely a reaction there from JJ. A little furrowing of the brow, the wide eyes.
And from Life Coach as well. Have you seen it? He actually like made a facial expression. It's like, yeah. Oh, I just got the innervate off
right.
the top.
Yes.
Yeah, that's actually a good strategy against JJ in particular.
Yeah.
Because what you said before, he's a really passionate
yes.
man about the game, so something like this might put him off.
Definitely.
Totally agree. Yeah.
JJ is known for his salt, and with Reynard stepping back as one of the players, I think JJ can take the throne of the Salt King.
Yeah, I'm definitely willing to give that title to him. He's his stream is very entertaining at times, let's put it this way. He has a few choice words for some people that managed to defeat him on ladder. But yeah, you definitely saw the reaction come out there. And there's an ongoing argument between a lot of people about whether the concealing information by using the card you had the whole time or, you know, using the top deck's card to tilt situation. But when it's just lethal, I think if you have the potential to tilt your opponent, that's pretty much optimal most of the time. So. Yeah, interesting stuff.
Absolutely. So here we are going to see the Paladin, which is a secret Paladin, as we can see with all the secrets. Redemption, Secret Keeper opening. Not the best, but Secret Keeper definitely always wanted in your opening hand.
Right. And this is one of people's big issues with Druid, is that, sure, there's matchups that, in theory, will defeat it, you know, with a reasonably favorable win rate, you know, acceptable good win rate against Druid.
Yeah.
The problem is when you come into a tournament format like this and you have to bring something that you rely on as part of your tournament strategy to beat Druid, in that one game, cards like Innervate and Wild Growth can make an extremely big mess of the supposed win rates of your matchup.
Yeah, I've discussed many matchups with a lot of people before, and that we agree to a matchup with Druid. Let's say, yeah, Druid has a bad matchup unless.
Yeah.
They draw innovative.
Exactly. Right, and that's all stuff that's calculated into the win rate, but it's, you know, overall you get the situation where, you know, they're only going to draw Innervate or Wild Growth this many times, and that's factored in, and so we get this overall win rate where the deck is unfavored. The problem is, in a one-off basis in a tournament setting, it's so unreliable, and Lothar, go ahead.
Yeah, Lothar, explain this. Why did Life Coach not...
Well, he just wants to play the Dr. Boom on turn 3, I guess. But I'm kind of surprised he didn't go for the Planted Shredder.
You wanted to turn 1 Shredder, turn 2 Wild Growth?
I'm kind of loving this because you have to be faster than the Paladin.
Right.
You just achieve board control, and then almost every single draw from the deck will get you further
in
that situation. You just snowball the damage from the drop from the Paladin.
I think the problem with that play is that it's okay definitely to play Shredder on turn 1, but then if there is you have Secret Keeper, if there's Noble Sacrifice with a different another secret, your Shredder gets blocked, and there is a Master for Battle follow-up, your Shredder is useless, and Secret Keeper is just continuing to kill you. And
but what is what if there's a Repentance right now?
Yeah,
repentance
is a serious consideration.
No, he's not. I think he didn't play it.
It was Noble Sack.
Noble Sack
Avenged Redemption.
That
got played, I believe.
I've seen Avenged in the opening hands. And Noble Sack and Competitive?
I thought it was Redemption.
Redemption, maybe. Yeah, Redemption.
I mean, you have to go for the Dr. Boom anyway. That was your plan all along. You can't switch the gears right now. And by the way, that Harrison Jones.
That Harrison Jones is going to be important. Life Coach gets the good news, no repentance, and the second Noble Sacrifice is pretty much the worst draw in the deck apart from the second event,
yeah,
which is just equally bad. Just an unplayable card this turn, complete whiff. This is a draw that can definitely happen to Secret Paladin.
Yeah.
JJ obviously frustrated, and this is a really, emotionally from JJ's perspective, this is a really bad time to be faced with a rough draw like this after he was obviously affected by the supposed top deck at the end of the previous game as well, so he'll be feeling like the world is against him right now.
Versus other classes, Noble Sacrifice can maybe work, but versus Druid, well, there's the just Shapeshift that can deal with it easily.
If the Avenge would land on actually Secret Keeper and you can play the Big Game Hunter on that, I think you go for it.
Oh my god, yeah. And, well, there's a chance that Knife Juggler is still alive. Oh, he only got hit for one anyway. I was going to say, so...
Really alive.
Yeah, there's a weird interaction where you can do enough damage to kill a minion that gets avenged, and then it still gets avenged and gains the health and stays alive. But with it only being one damage there anyway, it ended up being a formality.
Yeah, for JJ, this bomb has to go for face, or at least kill the 1-1. Like, he needs the 4-5.
I would say you actually attack first with the Dr. Boom to the Secret Keeper now, just to make the odds of killing the secret
Well, okay, so about odds.
In defense of that line, he might have been prioritizing the Knife Juggler higher than the Secret Keeper and said, okay, I'm going to see if the bomb will kill it, and if it doesn't, then I'll trade the Dr. Boom into the Knife Juggler instead.
But you know that the opponent isn't packing Massive of Babylon, is it?
Right, sure.
So, wasn't sure about it.
Yeah, I mean, it's debatable, but still, the Boombot solved the issue there for Life Coach anyway, so... Blessing of Kings into Noble Sacrifice is one of the better turns that JJ could have had out of that hand that he had that was a pretty big mess at the time.
It's still really hard for JJ though, because even though Life Coach is at 14 points of health, Paladin normally doesn't have much burst. Like, we've seen this Blessing of Kings being kind of bursty, but he already has to trade with minions and hope that he picks up maybe Mistress Challenger on 6, be able to follow up with Dr. Boom. Life Coach has everything he needs at the very moment.
So. He has 6 mana, he has a 4 drop and a hero power. He can think about the second Noble Sacrifice, he can think about the second Avenge, he can think about Competitive Spirit, and about a Repentance.
Yep.
So, if you think about Repentance, Pile the Shredder is the best option to play it. Then you play around Noble Sacrifice as well. So you play around 2 Secrets. So it seems like the best option would be actually to play the Pile the Shredder, but Life Coach plays into the Noble Sacrifice.
I think it's interesting because if you're paying attention to your opponent's hand, you know that secret that was played was the card that was drawn 2 turns ago where he hero power passed with 4 mana.
Yeah, yeah. So it can be one of the 3.
From that perspective, you're pretty sure it was one of those secrets that was equipped at the time because it was unplayable. So based on the common setup of the deck, it's either Avenge or Noble Sacrifice because they're the only duplicates. So in that situation, I find it interesting that he would choose to send Dr. Boom face and then take the 5 damage on the minion with his hero power instead of doing it the other way around.
Completely agree. I was caught off guard by this sequencing. Well, it's still not terrible for Life Coach.
Well, it's
he would still have to sacrifice the 7-1 into the 5-1, but he would not get 5 damage.
Yeah, he would just have some extra health right now. And honestly, the health isn't a big deal here because Paladin, as you said, Nimsh, earlier, is not famous for its burst damage. The one way they can sort of kind of burst you is from Ashbringer from Tyrion, where they can do the burst over several turns. But with Harrison Jones in hand, that's insurance against Ashbringer, True Silver Champion, Coghammer, any form of repetitive damage that might come out.
Yeah, the sad fact is
the
that
bombs.
JJ, even though he has Dr. Boom in his hand, there is this Big Game Hunter just waiting for it, which will be another tempo swing. And one of the ways that JJ can try to come back is maybe draw into Tyrion on turn 8 and then fall with Mistress Challenger. But then Mistress Challenger would not even bring Noble Sacrifice because we've seen 2 already.
Yeah, it will be 1 Avenge and a Competitive Spirit, I believe, will be the only. If it's the standard secret makeup that most people have agreed on now, it'll be a 2 secret Challenger.
Possibly
and not
Repentance.
Even the good ones.
We
right,
know, yeah.
Yeah, possibly a Repentance.
And he's on 1 Blessing of Kings, which is super important to play the Druid of the Claw in Taunt mode right now.
Yeah, so the Druid of the Claw is going to come down. We'll see what Life Coach is doing with it.
He's
again,
charging.
He's going to play the Taunt. And again, I understand like playing slowly, but I don't understand waiting until the absolute last moment every time. Because if we've ever seen Life Coach making misplays in tournament, it's just because
they
he just straight up runs out of time. So
exactly.
I understand his consideration for taking so long, but why wait until you have like 3 seconds left just to queue up all these actions where you have to choose one, press a hero power, drag it? Like,
it's his style.
It's just crazy.
He was
to
always
me.
Playing like
it's
that.
It's just insane to me. I've casted enough Life Coach games now to have seen him punished by that on numerous numerous occasions. Yeah. And he still keeps doing it.
Like, even a couple of turns before, right? Like, just taking extra damage
right.
for no reason, even though he took so much time to think about it. Yeah. But right now, this Tyrion is for JJ. So he might be able to come back unless there is a silence.
There's the Harrison chance. You just need the Savage Roar.
Oh, you're right, you're right.
Yeah, the Harrison is in hand, so as long as you have a clean way to destroy the Tyrion, you're good, and Savage Roar is a pretty clean way of doing that if you have a few minions on board. So still, that Tyrion might end up not being enough here from JJ, but what it does do is give him hope. He'll feel like maybe he has a chance now. Like, even if I don't have the board, if I get that Ashbringer, then I just have to smash him in the face a couple of times.
So talking about crazy chances, I'm like looking at this pilot, the Shredder, and thinking about Doomsayer already.
Yeah, I mean, this is going to be one.
Oh, look at JJ right now. Sorry for interrupting.
Right, that's fine.
But look at that face from JJ. He's not going to believe what's going to happen. And now his face will be even more concerned.
Yeah, good sequencing from JJ there, making sure that the bomb has the maximum chance of hitting a different target after the result of the first
isn't
boom bot.
Isn't he just dead?
Isn't he dead now?
I'm pretty sure that is just lethal with the Force of Nature draw, yeah.
Yeah, so that's basically it, just force.
JJ, a little bit of a bemused look on his face after that one, but yeah, the spiral definitely begun with that supposed top deck quote in the Warlock game that, you know, he had lethal in hand there anyway. Shredder positioning!
Woohoo! Wow. Direwolf Alpha, additional two stats, that's the damage.
It actually worked this time, but yeah, definitely Nightwatch had everything to win that game, and Dr. Boom so early, no response from JJ. It was really tough, and
by the way,
played by Life Coach.
Life Coach is a tall man, but JJ is even taller.
Oh yeah, JJ is a huge man. And
yeah, not that tall. Come on, guys.
Lothar, you know Life Coach a little bit better than I do. What are the odds on the first thing he said to JJ there was, by the way, I had lethal without the top deck dinner pay.
No, he won't say that. He won't say that. He will never say exactly what was the plan like all along.
Yeah,
he wants his opponent to like maybe rewind the games, see them themselves, what did they do wrong.
Yeah, basically Life Coach is really nice when you talk to him. Like, he BMs you enough with going to rope every
turn. Oh, yeah, yeah.
Then after the game finishes, he's like shaking your hand and saying, well played.
Right.